The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, short and succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. And at question number one, I call Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it is responding to the report Drug-Related Deaths in Scotland 2021, which was published on the 28th of July 2022.
Minister Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, every life lost to a drug death is a tragedy. The report which National Records of Scotland published in July showed that we lost 1,330 people to drugs in Scotland in 2021. Not statistics, but lives that ended far too soon, and each one underlining that we are still in the midst of a public health emergency. I will give a full statement on this issue on Thursday and will appear before three joint committees next week. However, this government's response will be to redouble our commitment to the national mission on saving and improving lives. The principles of which will guide us through this emergency are: follow the evidence, invest to transform services, and trust our lived and living experience.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. It is 3 years since the Scottish Government announced a public health emergency, and yet these figures demonstrate little emergency response. It is no wonder that the accusation of "we keep dying, you keep talking" continues. The progress on MAT standards in particular is lamentable, and while a year target has been set for 1 to 5 targets been introduced, the implementation on that timescale is a year behind what was initially promised. So can I ask what action has taken place over the summer to push for effective delivery on the MAT standards?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the scale of the loss of life in Scotland should not be underestimated. Drug deaths are, of course, preventable, unacceptable and tragic, and we all have a responsibility to play our part to turn the tide. In terms of MAT standards, Ms Baker will be aware that for the first time in Scotland, the government has issued ministerial direction. All authorities, whether chief executive officers and local authorities, IGBs, health boards, have received those letters. There is a clear expectation and demand that improvement plans and implementation plans have to be submitted to the government by the end of this month. We are in the process of gathering and scrutinising that information, and I will, of course, as per my previous commitments to Ms Baker and Chamber, be keeping Parliament fully updated around the crucial life-saving MAT standards. They are not a tick box and they are most certainly not optional. In terms of activity over the summer, she will have seen that we have published our National Mission Strategic Plan. The vital final recommendations from the Drugs Death Task Force have also been published too.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. So we have £250 million has been committed to this over 5 years, and we've had lots of announcements, but the key task here is to stop the deaths. So can I ask what the Scottish Government is doing to monitor the impact of interventions, how it is able to increase investment or expand activity in areas where progress is being made, and what additional support it is committing to ensure that we see progress and we start to see these figures come down significantly?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as I intimated in my initial answer, I will be responding to Parliament with respect to the vital report of the Drugs Deaths Task Force. But in terms of resource, I hope Ms Baker and others would accept that with the national mission monies, we see a 67% real terms increase. I have also endeavoured to ensure continuity of funding both to ADPs and to those vital grassroots organisations. We are pursuing a belt and braces approach in terms of funding frontline services, but also directly funding organisations as well. But the point that she raises, that investment isn't just about quantum, it is also about targeting to ensure that the resource reaches where it must reach. And that does fall on monitoring and evaluation. We are publishing more information than ever before to ensure efficacy, but also transparency, and also how we allocate money is vital to ensuring that we get cross-government but also cross-sector collaboration, and that we are both serious about reducing harm but also supporting recovery in this country.
Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all know that residential rehabilitation is absolutely life-saving and that it needs to be front and centre of the SNP Government's efforts to end Scotland's drug-related deaths epidemic. I was shocked to learn yesterday from my constituent James, who's a resident in Caldergrain in South Lanarkshire, that is more than half empty right now. There are 13 empty beds there at present. Minister, you said it's imperative that resources reach where it must reach. Three people are dying every day, Minister. So why are people not able to access these beds?
Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I appreciate that question from Ms Webber. I am indeed a powerful advocate for residential rehabilitation as part of that recovery-orientated whole system of care. Ms Webber will be aware that this government has committed £100 million. Thus far, we have made commitments around £23 million, which is both about utilising the unused capacity within the sector, but also increasing capacity in the sector over and above that. And for the first time ever, we have, in effect, ring-fenced money for residential rehab to alcohol and drug partnerships. And also, for the first time ever, we are monitoring the number of residential rehabilitation places that each ADP is funding. So I know that over the course of 2021-2022, over 500 placements were indeed funded. But if there are particular issues about the care pathway for her constituent, I would be more than happy, and indeed it's my duty to hear about it, so she'd be very welcome to contact me separately on that matter.
Question number two, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it can confirm if Hull 801 will be delivered by May 2023 and Hull 802 by December 2023, and within the latest cost-to-complete budget of £123 million.
Minister Ivan McKee.
The target date for the completion of Hull 801 Glensannox remains by the end of May 2023, and for Hull 802 by the end of December 2023. The current budget to complete both vessels remains £123 million, as set out by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy update to Parliament on 23rd of March 2022. The Deputy First Minister and Minister for Transport were able to see firsthand the progress made on both vessels during their visit to the shipyard on 2nd August this year. We continue to press the shipyard to continue to progress to completion of the vessels in this agreed time frame and within budget.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So the answer is they'll be delivered on the latest timescale and on the latest budget. We know there's only £30 million left in the budget plot and at least another 15 months of build time. So, frankly, an overspend is probably inevitable. Given the latest disastrous information on harbour upgrades, in what year would both ferries be operational on their planned routes?
Minister.
As I had indicated, the completion dates for those ferries are the end of May 2023 and the end of December 2023, and both ferries will begin into operation, obviously, after those dates. Work is continuing to make sure that the turnaround in the yard is delivering to those results, and also the yard is increasingly becoming more competitive to allow it to bid for other business going forward.
Edward Mountain.
So there we have it, Minister. What we've got is a Scottish Government that doesn't even know when the infrastructure will be in place to allow the ferries to operate on the route. We've had a Scottish Government that's mucked up on the contract, the nationalisation in the yard, and will overspend their budget and will delay to build the harbour infrastructure that we so desperately need. What more could possibly have gone wrong?
Minister.
I think the member's incorrect. The harbour infrastructure has been put in place to ensure that the ferries can operate. And as I've said already, the completion dates for those ferries are, as I've already indicated, and the work continues to make the yard more competitive so that it can bid for and win more work on the open market. And that's what this government's focused on, saving the jobs, saving the shipyard, making sure that commercial shipbuilding on the Clyde has a future. And if we'd listened to others, we would not be in this position today, and we wouldn't have saved those more than 300 jobs over that period of time. That's what's important. That's what this government cares about, the industrial future of that sector on the Clyde.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has demonstrated its crystal clear commitment to the communities which are served by the ferry services, but also the strong commitment to ensuring that the proud tradition of shipbuilding continues in Port Glasgow and the Clyde, and that jobs are protected from those who would have actually closed the yard. What can the Government, and indeed Ferguson Marine, do to give the yard a secure future and guarantee the jobs and skills for generations to come?
Minister.
Stuart McMillan is of course right to highlight the need for us all to work to give the yard and future generations of employees a secure future. There will be potential work available from this Government. We have previously said that we will have a small vessels programme and there will be longer term proposals to invest in new ferry vessels. We would want Ferguson Marine to be in a position to secure some of that work, but whether it is from this Government, other public sources or the private sector, the yard needs to be competitive. We have made clear our expectation in this regard. We continue to monitor progress closely. There are a lot of changes being put in place since the new Chief Executive was appointed earlier this year, and we can now see and say that significant progress has been made. The yard is back to being a serious contender for future vessel contracts, and I would hope that that is something that everyone in this chamber could welcome and get behind.
Katie Clark.
Thank you. The substitute vessel being used on the Ardrossan to Arran route is now 38 years old. CMAL say that they have looked at over 600 vessels in recent years, but only managed to procure one. Could the Minister confirm when Project Neptune will be published, but also will the Scottish Government commit to bringing forward a more sustainable plan to build capacity and construct vessels here in Scotland?
Minister.
I can make the member aware that my colleague, the Minister for Transport, will be in the chamber on Thursday to give an update on those very issues, and look forward to hearing from her the progress that's been made and the plans that are in place to address the issues that the member raised.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. The Minister has already been asked about harbour upgrades, but didn't seem to give a very clear answer. The Ardrossan Harbour Task Force was formed over 6 years ago. We still have no agreement on who is going to pay for what and when the work will be done. So can the Minister say today when Ardrossan Harbour will be ready to take the Glen Sannox?
Minister.
The member will be aware that, of course, Peel Ports are the owner of that facility, but the Government is committed to making sure that this issue is resolved. My colleague, the Minister for Transport, is working on this. As I've already said, we're working to ensure that that's in place for when the ferries will be operational.
That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 5882 in the name of George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, on changes to this week's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now, and I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member is asked to speak against the motion, therefore the question is that motion 5882 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed.